Here we are with Legal Ease, Episode 1. We're very excited to be here. We're going to be talking about entrepreneurialism. We're going to be talking about law, answering a lot of legal questions that we get very frequently, and talking about how entrepreneurs can build small businesses, engage in the local community. That's going to be the theme of what we're talking about. I'm Ryan Peabody. This is my colleague, Greg Treat.
Hello.
We are attorneys. We are here in Southlake, Texas, and I'm ready to get right into it, Greg.
All right. Well, today we're going to be talking about three things. First, we're going to give a brief introduction as to what this show is and why we're doing it. Second, we're going to talk about the concept of a local business, what that is, why it's important, and how, as a business owner, you need to understand how you fit in your community. And third and finally, we're going to be talking about how to leverage social currency as we go through trying times
important.
Like what we're going through right now.
Right.
So first of all, what is this show? What's the purpose of it? What's the inspiration? Why are we doing this, Ryan?
The purpose of it is our expertise in law is we help a lot of business owners get up and running, get operational, do things like contract structure businesses. But I'll tell you what we also do is we also talk about how to build a business with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I've certainly done it myself. You've been a part of it. And it's how to engage in the community to sell the goods you produce or the services that you deliver. And doing that in a very thoughtful, structured manner is going to just yield good results.
Mm-hmm. Well, obviously you're a business owner in this community, right? So prior to this this current crisis, you were out networking. How much would you say you networked before COVID?
So that's a great question. Let's just jump right into networking, because networking is another name for marketing and advertising. See, a lot of small businesses, they don't really have the dollars to spend on marketing and putting ads together and doing things like that. And quite frankly, they really don't need to.
Mm-hmm.
All they need to do is be in their community and be present and be involved so that people know they're there. I got asked a question a long time ago about how I got business from a family member.
Right.
And she asked me, she goes, yeah, how do you get business? You just hang up your shingle and just wait for people to come in? Absolutely not. You go out in the community and you start interacting with groups that are oriented to what you're doing.
Right.
So broadly speaking, you get involved in business groups. If you're a small business owner, you're just getting started, you need to know hundreds of people in your community. That's how you get your name out there, and that's how you start doing business well. There are a lot of groups that are teed up for this, that are ready to go, that are ready to accept you, that want to do business, that want to do networking. Top of my list for anybody just getting going in a new community or a new business, Chamber of Commerce.
Right,
that's an easy one. They have structured events. Under normal circumstances, I know right now, mid-2020, we're talking about COVID and there's restrictions. This will go away, we certainly hope, sooner rather than later. But traditionally, they have structured events. There are luncheons. There are business exchanges where you go and you shake people's hand and say, hey, what do you do? This is what I do. There are other civic groups, Kiwanis, Rotary. There are 1,000 ways to get involved in your local community. You could even go to city council meetings, or or various different governmental type meetings that are involved in all of the key issues in running that city or that county or wherever you are. And it's important to, the more local, the better.
Right.
But get involved, be present. Let people know your name. Let them tell them what you do.
Right. So you just used the word local. And I said earlier that one of our key points is what is a local or dealing with local businesses. So let's start with the first question. What is a local business and why did we choose that word instead of something like, say, small business or family owned business?
A local business is somebody that is involved locally. So a local business is not necessarily kind of your mom and pop startup. It's not necessarily your medium business or your large business. It's really it's really a geography.
Right.
And it's easy to select a city and use that city as a geography.
Right.
So, for example, here in Southlake, we have a lot of small businesses and a lot of very big businesses. And so we have a Costco or a Kohl's or these sort of big businesses. Their brand name is out there. Everybody knows who they are. And they don't really need to be networking and going to smaller events in the community because people already know about them, and that's fine. That's where they are. But these are huge international or national just juggernaut businesses. They're right. massive, and they that's a different paradigm than what we're talking about. We're talking about where the owner is the one that, as we would call in law, the rainmaker, right? The person that goes out and makes it happen through making those key connections. That's what we're talking about. But big businesses can also be small local businesses. For example, we have here locally a Hilton Hotel. And Hilton, international name, everybody says, have you heard of Hilton Hotel? Most people say, yes, I've heard of Hilton Hotel.
Doesn't get any more
I may have even stayed there, that kind of a thing. Here locally, for example, the particular Hilton that is in our town, the GM, I know from experience, makes an effort to connect with as many businesses as he possibly can. He goes out, he does network, he mm-hmm. does do those things, even though he's got a big brand business, and he does a lot of business with local people, hosting different charity banquets,
right.
or hosting different business exchange type events, or big Christmas parties, or different things like this that he may not have gotten to do if he didn't go out and meet these people in an authentic way. We'll talk more about how to be authentic here in a minute, but that's the idea.
Right.
And it's even more important for small business owners where you've got two people, three people, one person. You need to go out and shake people's hands, tell what you do, be a good listener, and build out that local network. That's what's being local.
Right. I think one of the great phrases that you use all the time that summarizes this idea really well is that a business is a promise. And so to be effective, what it means to as a local business is that you have someone that's making that promise and that's committed to keeping that promise in the local community. And that person has to be a decision maker. They don't necessarily have to be the owner, but most of the people that are successful in doing the local business thing do own their own business, unless you have the rare situation where you have like a Hilton where the local manager has the ability and our particular local manager has the desire to be that promise keeping person out there.
And I've seen that as uncommon, which is unfortunate as you're building a smaller business, because it is such an easy way to drive business and to get involved. And by promise, what do you mean by that? So if I'm a lawyer, for example, and I go out and say, okay, well, I can help you with business or estates or whatever our core competency is, they're going to call me up maybe and if they need that. And they say, hey, I need help with this. And I'm going to follow through with that. I'm going to do a follow-up phone call. I'm going to connect with them and answer their questions. I'm going to be a good listener. And I'm going to say, hey, I offer law, and then I'm going to follow through with that. It's pretty simple. It's pretty much A to B.
Mm-hmm.
I promise it, I'm going to do it, and I actually do it.
Right. Well, and that gives you the opportunities if you're involved in the community. Right now, every municipal group, every county, every city is at least thinking about, if not starting, revitalization efforts, things to bring us out of whatever crisis is taking place locally. Obviously, right now, it's the COVID issue. You can go and be involved and find people that are involved in the same kinds of things as you, that care about the same issues, that are in a similar position.
Yes. So here's the key point under any economic circumstances is if you're going to be involved in the community, select a community that you is convenient for you geographically. Mm-hmm. All right. Your territory really is going to be within that city or within a 15 or 20 mile radius, like at the very most. And you want to be consistent. So if you're going to go to Chamber of Commerce events, go to all of them. If you're going to go to a Rotary, go to all of them. Volunteer at all of the organizations. Volunteer to help put on different events.
Mm-hmm.
And get to the point where you become the guy
right.
or the girl.
Right.
And that's who they know you as, that person.
And by all of them, you mean all of them for that specific
group. For that specific organization. So here's one mistake I see a lot of small business owners making, and you can avoid this very easily. There are, let's use Chamber of Commerce still, there are chambers of commerce in most major cities. And in our area, we got a lot of cities that are kind of very close to each other.
Mm-hmm.
So in theory, you could go to the events for all of these different chambers or all these different events in the entire area.
Right.
And I see what happens is I see some people get on a schedule. So they'll go to every third event for this city, and then every third event for that city, and they're in their mind they're covering more ground.
Right. But they're deluding themselves.
But they're deluding themselves, right. So I would encourage somebody, and we've seen a lot of people be successful. We've certainly been successful with not diluting yourself, but rather be hyper present in one location or one area, and let people get to know you intimately there.
Right.
So I cannot tell you how many times I've had an interaction with somebody and they didn't even know my name till the fourth or fifth time I shook their hands, or maybe the 10th time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fine.
Right.
That's totally fine. But I want to get to whatever that threshold is. So if everybody in that room doesn't know my name until the 30th time that I've showed up to an event and have said hello to them, then I'm going to go to that 30th time.
Right.
To where they know me and I know them, and I am remembering their name for whatever system I have. I'm writing it down on their business card. I'm giving them my business card. You just got to be, if you're going to be local and be present and be consistent. Consistency is the is going to be the person who wins that race.
Right.
That's who's going to do it. So many times there might be a networking event like early in the morning, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock in the morning before business hours. And I've woken up and I'm laying in bed and I just don't want to go. And I rally and I go anyway. And it's almost always those instances where something great comes out of it.
Right.
I make the connection, or somebody goes, hey, you know what? I've been looking for you. I need what you have. And then you're off to the races.
Right.
Same thing with the evening stuff. And I realize people have kids, they have families, they have other stuff that they need to do. But if at all possible, if you can arrange to go to these events, either take your kids or get a babysitter or make it happen, particularly when you're in the early stages in the first couple of years of building that business, it is just so important to your success. And that is going to give you a competitive advantage now, and it's going to start kicking off results over the long term as well.
Right.
So that's a good starting point.
Well, I think for many of our audience, they've already done these things. They were involved in the events. And I think one of the things to remember is things are still happening. They're happening in different formats, in different venues, online, through written means. And a lot of that is uncomfortable, but it's the same principle as when you were first starting out as a business owner. It's the same principles when you were first going to those events. There was a lot of things that were uncomfortable, that were not your strong suit. And you pushed through, you were consistent, you were steadfast, and you made it work. There are people out there that still want to connect with you, even in this crisis. So that's kind of point number one. And the second point is, if you were involved in your community, and you were, even if you weren't sort of involved in the sense that we're talking about, but you were a successful business owner, you have been building a social currency with your employees, with your vendors, with your customers and clients, and with the community at large that you need to recognize and tap into at times like this. So Ryan, could you tell us a little bit more about social currency?
Social currency is a great way to put it, particularly in challenging economic times.
Right.
So most people think of their business as having a bank account, and that bank account has money in it that they're going to survive with during challenging economic times or good times. They start deploying capital in various ways to grow their business, to sustain their business, things like that. But what a lot of entrepreneurs overlook at various levels of business, I see your entry-level entrepreneurs and I see your very experienced level entrepreneurs, they overlook the second bank account. And that bank account is full of social currency. And what I mean specifically are relationships. You have relationships with people and you have a currency with them. So to put it into very real terms, I hear the advice a lot where if you get a business going, people say, hey, start out with your friends and family and go to them and see if they'll do business with you, right? You can learn from this and you can maybe get a little business going and then expand out from there. What they're really saying to you is go to people that you have social currency with.
Right.
People that know you and already have a level of familiarity and trust with you. And you can take that. So you've already done this. You may not realize it.
Right.
So you could take that idea of building these relationships and expand it to the broader community, to where you are interacting with so many people, you become trusted and you have you build this equity in the community. I'll give you an example. So I have a client and a good friend of mine who is a restaurateur, owns a variety of restaurants. and the COVID crisis hit and all the restaurants were shut down. And he came to me and he said, we're going to have a problem like paying our people, paying our bills. You know, where do I start? And I said, you probably have a whole list of vendors that you get food from, that you get, you know, people that you owe money to in the course of business. And he said, yes, I do. And I said, what you want to do right now, and you have contracts with these people. Mm-hmm. So you have 90-day terms, 30-day terms where you're getting, you know, their product and you're paying your bills.
Right.
So I said, what you want to do right now is start calling all these people. How long have you been doing business with them? Mm-hmm. I asked him, and he said, some of them years, some of them decades. He said, I have a very good relationship with these people that I built up. And I've paid my bills so consistently. I call them, they answer the phone. Right. It's a good relationship. So I said, you want to start right now and say, hey, listen, I may have a problem paying my bills. I want to pay my bills, but I need different terms. Mm-hmm. I need 120 days. I may even need longer than that. Mm-hmm. Or let me give you a partial payment or something different. And he said, I don't know. I'm not sure if I can do that. I said, do it. Call them. See what they say.
Make the call.
Called me back. He said, I called a dozen of my different food vendors that I get different products from, everything from alcohol to chicken. Mm-hmm. And he goes, every single one of them said, I know you, I trust you, I'm going to continue to work with you, and I'm going to give you those terms. I'm going to give you every discount that I can,
right,
because your success is my success.
Right. Absolutely.
If you come out of a harsh economic time and you're still in business and you're still buying from me, that's a win-win.
Right.
And he said, I was amazed. And he goes, I was able to get through those times and have enough time to kind of restructure my business and be dynamic about it. Mm-hmm. To be even healthier than ever.
Right.
And that was amazing. And I said, congratulations. That's you just use your social currency, mm-hmm, in addition to your actual dollars and cents.
Right.
Well done.
Well, and you know, another restaurant story, since because it's such a common success story throughout all this, has been all of the restaurants that have converted from brick and mortar locations and converted to entirely delivery or partial delivery,
sure, sure,
outside, where they went to their employees and said, all right, well, we hired you for one job description. This was what we were going to do. And we can't pay you anymore because that's just not where things are right now. We may even have to pay you a little less, but here's the job. Here's the new job description. You're now a delivery driver. And I think people that trusted, that had built up their social currency and trusted in that currency with their employees and said, this is how we're going to keep your job and keep you moving forward, they were very successful.
You're also talking here about being dynamic.
Right.
And moving quickly with the times. Mm-hmm. So there was another restaurant here. Restaurants are great examples because they all got shut down during the COVID crisis that's still going on.
They had to innovate.
They had to innovate, and they had to innovate overnight. And I've seen a lot of restaurants go out of business and shut down because they sat there with their existing business model and they said, I guess we'll just try to figure it out. No good.
No good.
I saw one restaurant in particular that within 2 or 3 days of them actually being shut down by the government because of COVID, they stripped their menu down to just a couple of items and they pulled all of their servers, mm-hmm, and their cooks and everybody that was that would have been maybe fired or let go or furloughed during this challenging time. They pulled them all into a meeting and said, we're not going to fire any of you. Mm-hmm. We think we can still do business. We've got a simplified menu. And for all you servers, you're now not servers. You're now delivery drivers.
Right.
And they put out the word to the community. They said, hey, we've got a simpler menu. It's inexpensive and effective. It's still that same quality that you've come to expect from us. And we're going to deliver it to your home, wherever you live. And I think they had like a 20-mile radius. It was huge. Yeah. And they stayed afloat and they stayed in business. And I talked to the manager some weeks later and he said, we're busier than we've ever been.
Right.
We're putting out more food than we've ever put out before.
Right.
And I just said, that's because you innovated.
Right.
And he says, that's exactly right. We innovated. And he goes, we're doing well. And that restaurant's going to survive. And that's a success story. So many people can succeed and do exceptionally well in times of crisis if they innovate.
Right.
The people that I'm just going to be very blunt, that are complaining about, well, the economy's not good, I can't do this, I can't do that. The market doesn't care about I can't.
Right.
It cares about innovation and quality and consistency, mm-hmm, of goods and of services. And so those are the people that are going to survive and flourish.
Right. Well, and that, you know, again, we want this to be a point of encouragement, because as we said, I think at the beginning of this discussion,
yes. Be encouraged.
Every single business owner that we talk to these issues about radically underestimates the value that they provided to the community, the times where they stood by their employees when they needed time off from work, when a crisis happened at home, a time when they went above and beyond the extra mile for a customer, you know, sometime when they were just really good to work with for a vendor. These things matter to people. And just by being the kind of upstanding, you know, people use terms like the pillar of the community, that's a real thing. People value stability. They value the effect of stability that you had on your business.
Yeah, and that's consistency.
Right.
So let's talk about one more thing. And I hear this from time to time where somebody says, I live in a town or I live in a city that is just nothing's happening.
Right.
It might be a rural area, or it might be an area that just not a lot is happening, or it's particularly impacted by a down economic turn. I get that. The last thing that I will say to the entrepreneurs, or if you want to be an entrepreneur, you want to leave one career, start another business, be prepared to move. You want to put yourself in an environment that is flourishing, that is good environment to be in. If what you deliver just is not good for that environment, then move to an environment that is good. And I have seen people pack up everything they own in their car and drive to another state, drive to another area, having done the analysis, and we can get into how to do that analysis in a later episode, looking at socioeconomics, looking at demographics, who consumes my good or service, mm-hmm. and where they live. You want to put yourself in a target-rich environment if you can, and don't be afraid to move. Maybe you live in a hometown and you just really want to build that local business. Fine, get after it, get to know people. But If you want to move and you feel like you need to move to a better area to have better opportunities, if you can do it. And most people can move.
And
they should, if they need to.
Make sure, if you're doing that local business, make sure that you know, it's like crops. You need to identify what grows well in your environment, what will sell well in your environment, in business terms, what'll sell.
Yeah, use crops as a metaphor. I'm not in South Florida growing potatoes. All right. I'm not in Idaho where potatoes are growing avocados.
Not a good business model.
Don't be a potato in Florida.
Right.
Be a potato in Idaho. Go to a place that you are going to be in an environment where you can flourish and your business can flourish. And don't be afraid to take that risk. Do your homework. Be prepared. Have that business model in place. But be flexible enough to pack up yourself, pack up your family, and go to where you need to go.
Well, in conclusion, we think that there is a lot of reason for optimism. There's a lot of reason to have hope and to really stand your ground and to move forward with the promises that you've made, because your business is a promise. And if you've been keeping that promise for years, there's no reason why you can't survive and thrive even in these situations. Thank you for watching this episode of the Legal E Show, and we'll see you next time.
See you next time. Thanks.